We have a distinguished panel of Roosevelt professors here today who are prepared to share their immigration story and to talk about the American dream from their perspective. Before I ask them to introduce themselves, as the president mentioned, I don't know if people got when they came in, there is a shortened version of the U.S. citizenship test, 10 questions, not the 100 questions, but 10 questions. So if you haven't taken it to see how you fare, please try getting a copy for yourself. And I think there are copies of the U.S. Constitution, should you be so moved to check that out. So before we get started, I'd like to ask each of the professors to introduce themselves, their name, the title, their department, and the country that they've immigrated from.
Jim Choca, psychology. I came from Cuba, and I'm a professor in psychology. What year? 60.
Hello. I'm Kyungmi Choi, music composition, associate professor in music composition from CCPA, and I came from South Korea. It's been 20 years.
안녕하세요. 저는 유아교육학과 김진아 교수입니다. 여러분을 만나게 되어서 정말 반갑습니다. 오늘 얘기를 많이 하게 될 텐데요. 잘 듣고 질문 있으시면 꼭 얘기해 주세요. Hello. Are you surprised? You thought a little bit that I'm in the wrong place, but you're in the right place. I am Gina Kim. I am associate professor that I got this year. In early childhood education, in college of education, I came from South Korea, like Kyungmi, and it's 20th year mark today, actually. So I'm very happy to be here 20 years.
It sounded like you were saying only friendly things. I'm Zarko Minkov in philosophy here, and I'm from Bulgaria.
Hi, my name is Bedriana Kocevic. I am an assistant professor of clinical sciences with the Department of Clinical and Administrative Sciences at the College of Pharmacy up at Schaumburg. And I came here from Bosnia via Croatia.
Hi, my name is Wilfredo Urbina Romero. I'm associate professor at the math department, and I came from Venezuela.
I'm Cornelius Watson. I'm associate professor of biology and the chair of the department, and I'm from Jamaica, and I came in the fall of 1979.
That's great. Well, thank you all for joining this panel. They are not shy. So when it comes to the question and answer portion, I hope that you all have some questions for them. Again, my name is Lawrence Benito. I'm the Chief Executive Officer with the Illinois Coalition for Immigrant and Refugee Rights. We are a 30-year-old coalition that, as our name implies, advocates with and for immigrants and refugees. We are a statewide organization, and we're composed of 130 member organizations across the state. And we work at the city, county, local and federal levels to advocate for immigrants to participate fully in the social, cultural, political, economic life of our diverse society. I come to this work both personally and professionally. My parents are both immigrants from the Philippines. My mom came in 67. My dad came in 68. They weren't married then. My mom, when she came in 67, said, you know, she was, just had finished nursing school and had the opportunity, because there was a nursing shortage in this country, to come. And she said to my dad, I've got a dream, and I'm going to America. And if you love me, you'll find a way to get there, too. And it took my dad, you know, about 9 months to get a tourist visa to come. But as they say, the rest is history. I was born shortly after that. You know, I come to this work because I saw the challenges and opportunities that my parents faced navigating two worlds, right? The world in which, you know, they grew up, and then their new adopted home, and having to navigate both the new culture, the different values between the two countries. I saw them struggle to figure out their place. You know, immigrants talk about the sense of belonging in coming to their new country, but also finding their voice. I know as a child, there were often times where my parents, probably not much older than some of my youngest kids, I have four, but I remember going out to restaurants, and my parents would turn to me and say, "Well, you can order for us." And I thought to myself, you know, I'm just an 8-year-old kid. Why am I ordering, you know, for the family? But implicit in that was, you know, you were born here, you can speak, you know, without an accent, and, you know, the people will understand you. Well, as a child, you know, I didn't know any better. You know, I did it. But that, you know, there was always something uncomfortable, you know, inside of that. And it's those kind of moments that I think, you know, brought me to the job and profession that I do now, because a lot of what we do is helping people to find their voice, right? To find their voice so that they feel comfortable, you know, in this country. I think this panel's very timely. Obviously, we're in the throes of a presidential election year. The issue of immigration has been front and center. September 17th is National Citizenship Day, so there are a lot of events this week talking about the issue of citizenship. And if you follow the public discourse around immigration, you know that oftentimes it's not necessarily shed in a positive light, right? Despite the fact that, you know, 40% of the Fortune 500 companies in this country were started by immigrants or the children of immigrants, right? Or immigrants are twice as likely as native-born Americans to start businesses, right? In fact, you know, a lot of the focus is spent on the 11 million undocumented people in this country, as opposed to the 13 million legal permanent residents, of which 8 million are eligible to become citizens right now, today, right? In Illinois, there are about 550,000 legal permanent residents. Approximately 375,000 are eligible to become citizens today. So you can imagine, as an organization, we do citizenship work. We help people through the process. And we do that because we believe, you know, one of the responsibilities is registering to vote and getting out to vote, right? And so part of building power for immigrant communities is through taking the next step to becoming citizens. And I'm proud to say that since 2005, our organization has helped over 100,000 people, directly assisted 100,000 legal permanent residents become U.S. citizens. You know, for those who follow history know the issue of immigration has always been a thorny one. It's not just this particular election, right? You go back to the 1850s and the Know Nothing Party, right? Or the 1880s with the Chinese Exclusion Act. Or, you know, more recently within the 1930s with the repatriation of Mexican-American citizens. I could go on and on, but I'm mindful of the time, and we've got lots of panelists up here who want to talk about their personal stories, and we'll probably go in order here. And I'm asking the panelists to take between 5 and 7 minutes to talk about their immigration story, you know, why they came, the conditions in which they left, and their take on current day, their perspective on the American dream. Thank you.
Thank you. So I'm going to take you back to Cuba in 1960. It was a year and a half or so after Castro had taken over. And many members of my family were already sort of turned off by some of the things that Castro was doing. My father was a little bit of socialist, leftist type of individual. And he had no problem with most of the things that Castro was doing, something that at times created some controversy in the extended family, but be that as it may. My father was also a very religious type of individual. He was more Catholic than the Pope. And this was at a time when popes were Catholic prior to Francis taking over. And when Castro decided he was taking over the Catholic schools, he lost my father for good. Right then and there, my father started making preparations for us to leave. This was no longer a place to be at from his point of view. So, shortly thereafter, one of his patients called him up on the phone and told him that the following day, they were going to send a list of physicians to the airport. And because they were losing too many physicians all at once, sort of thing, they were going to bar any physicians from leaving the country. And so this patient told my father, if you want to leave, you have to do it today. And so my father left in a hurry. In no time, he had packed whatever he needed and ran to the airport and got in a flight to Miami as a standby passenger. We waited until it was our time when we had the tickets and that kind of thing, 2-3 weeks later. And when we were about ready to board the plane, my name was called, and I was taken to a military outpost, and I was detained. Now, I think everybody knew that at 15 years old, I wasn't the doctor they were looking for, but Cuba is a military dictatorship, and you cannot do anything without the proper authority of all the people on top of you, sort of thing. And so it took quite a while before they had permission to let me go. And at that point, they took me in a military jeep to the plane. The plane was already taxiing to get into the runway. And so when we came in, they had to shut off it was a propeller, four engine propeller plane. They had to shut off all the propellers, and they had to pull in one of these stairways sort of thing, and to let me in into the cabin. After that, they closed the plane up, and we took off. For the next 10 minutes or so, that cabin was completely silent. You could hear a pin drop. And this is particularly unusual with a cabin full of Cubans, since we Cubans have two volumes, loud and unbearably loud. And so to have plane full of Cubans and no one talking was pretty strange. About 10 minutes into the flight, the pilot announced that we had just cleared the Cuban airspace. And then the cabin went crazy. We had escaped. We were free, this type of thing. And so Chicago, let's see, yesterday's paper, they were, and the headline was, there were 3,000 people shot during this year already. We have problems. The shootings in Chicago is just one of many problems that we have to work hard at facing. But one thought is that in spite of our problems, there are some things that we have going for us. Cuba, being the military state that it is, has none of those problems. Cuba's completely safe. No one will attack you or do anything with you. But yet, you have all of these people wanting to get out rather than people wanting to come in. And the reason, the big difference is that we have freedom in this country. And in spite of all of the problems, that freedom is worth what we have to pay for. November 8th, we will be voting, and our votes will be counted after we vote and not before. And that's worth being here. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Summarizing about 20 years of my life in 5 minutes is not gonna go well, but I'll try. My reason coming to the United States is actually just purely personal reason. When I was born, I really loved music, and my parents were music lovers, but they were not necessarily forcing me to go to heavy, very competitive music school. So I was basically listening music and enjoying music, but not necessarily following any kind of educational system there. And I, at the same time, happened to really love science, so I was studying chemistry there in Korea. And also, while I was doing it, I just realized deep down somewhere, there was some kind of thing that I really wanted to explore, wasn't really touched, even when I was undergrad, you know, age. So I explored a little bit, and I wanted to talk to some of the people there saying, is it possible for me to actually seriously study music? And 9 out of 10, whoever I talked to, they all said, you're too late. The reason why they said it is actually because the education system in South Korea, probably some of you already know about, it's very competitive, and especially music or art scenes, you have to really start from very, very young age. So if you're not out of that track, you're not in the track, then you're very likely kind of screwed. So so yes, I was screwed. And I had to face that dilemma of how I'm gonna actually live my life with this very limited condition. So what I did was, since my parents both were actually German literature professors, so I also really, really love literature, so I wanted to actually study then literature. So I took another path, and when I went to a master program in learning Korean literature, what I learned there was actually what they were doing was just studying scholarly-oriented theory based on literature, adopting a lot of Western philosophy on top of that. And when I was there, I realized, this is actually not what I wanted either. And I came back to, you know, 0 point that I wanted to create. And that put me even further a difficult position, because it seems like there's nothing I could do besides just going around private teachers and learning something. But even for them, they were very sort of pessimistic about my future. So I had to somehow find other way. And it was very unusual for anyone to study music formally, even though I taught myself how to play here and there, in age 25. So everybody was looking at me. You know what? Everybody has a dream. But, you know, not all the dreams will come true. So they were telling me, you know what? That's good to have that dream in your mind, but just, you know, enjoy music and do your thing. So a lot of people trying to tell me, everybody had that, but you don't have to really kill yourself. But the more I carried on, I just thought, I have only one life, I want to do something, and that's when I decide to leave the country. And it sounds like very dramatic, but at the same time, it was just like year by year, a cumulative kind of thing coming to me. So it was, to me, more like a gradual outcome than like one day I'm going to go somewhere. So what I did was I had to find some kind of help. I just searched around some teachers. I could actually start writing something. And I landed in this place. And if I think back, I was just 25 year old, you know, and of course it's much later than whoever studied any music in 5 year old age. But in my retrospect, in everything considering, 25 year old is just like a beginning of a life. So when I was, you know, turning down by age, and also there's another point of, because I was female, you're gonna get married very soon, couple of years. What's the whole point about making of this fuss? You know, that was another kind of a very generous advice from people that I had. So from age and gender issue was actually just in my life. And when I was listening to all that, I wasn't really like acting very, you know, like a monstrous way, but deep down somewhere, I knew they were not telling me truth. So when I came here and then going through all the struggles of learning language in proper way and also learning new environment and everything, still there is a, something in my heart that I was doing right thing. Not because I left my country, not because I just didn't follow the tradition of what had happened, because I listened to my heart. And that made me feel really like strong inside. And you know, when I see my students these days, that's the exact same thing I encourage them to look for, is what your heart is telling you and what is something that you want to stick to. Then eventually, how long it's going to take, it's going to go right direction. And that's where I found me moving here and learning all this thing that I never knew before and getting to know a lot of differences from South Korea in the States. I became a different person. I'm sure I had a potential earlier on, but it wasn't probably, or it shouldn't, or it couldn't be realized until I came here and actually, you know, struggled through. So I'm very grateful for so many reasons that this country existed and let me start music even when I was very late and allow me to explore things that probably other, you know, area couldn't do. Because I studied science, I wanted to explore science area with music, you know, making, and in Korea they were laughing at me. They're literally laughing at me. But here it was like, try, you know. And so from there I started developing some newer way of thinking about music and sound. It all became very unique in my own way. And that's why I'm so grateful for this country to provide me opportunity to be who I am, and not as someone who couldn't fulfill their dream, therefore they were twisted inside and they couldn't really handle someone's success. I am so grateful that I didn't turn into be that kind of person and really truly support whoever wants to fulfill their dream. So that I am very happy about too, for myself and for people around me. Second thing I have observed through my life here, since I've been here from since 1995, I've been seeing America actually changed quite a bit, from probably some more positive to negative side or negative to positive side. However you look at, there are issues and there are problems. And you know, probably among all here, I'm not still citizen here, so I may not be qualified to be here, but I'm still, I'm here as a permanent resident. And because my country doesn't allow dual citizenship, I'm still trying to see the way that I can either do dual citizen or much later, or maybe not trying to naturalize here at all. But that's not really changing my life or how I see America at all, because only thing that I cannot do is vote. But I will encourage all people around me to vote the way that, you know, that it impacted this country. But the sad thing about the way country has been shifting is more like, in a way, extremism and divisions are more welcome. And under the sense of freedom, people just think that freedom is do things what I want to do, not so much about freedom in a sense that allowing people to express their thing, however caring about other people's understanding as well with perspectives. That notion is starting to fading. That concerned me the most. So, you know, even though I'm not a citizen here, since I'm living here and I'm going to I'm planning to live long-term, I want to contribute to, as much as I can, to foster the freedom and the core of what America should be in my own way. And I hope everybody can join me in the sense too. Thank you for listening.
So I am South Korean. Actually, I'm Korean-American, I think, because I went through the immigration and then went through the citizenship in 2012. So I took that test, studying for 100 test questions for days because I was worried, because I didn't want to fail and then look really bad that I'm a college professor and not pass it. So I had that fear, so I had to study for it. I came to United States in 1996 because of a personal reason, as Kyungmi said. I was a school teacher, and then I am very rambunctious, and then I'm gullible, but at the same time, I have a lot of energy, and I like to talk to people to change things. And I was talking to my principal, things to change, and it didn't go through. As a Korean culture, you have to be subordinated to your authority, and then a lot of obstacles to overcome. So I really didn't like it. So I talked to my parents, I'm gonna go study abroad. And they were like, you're 24, are you crazy? You're getting married soon. I said, I'm not marrying. I wanna be a single forever. I am married, by the way. I am a woman myself. I'm gonna be not married. So I was not going to marry. So I said, I'm gonna go. So they suggested me to go to Japan, which is right next to Korea, if you don't know, right? A lot of people say that to me, the first question, did you drive here from South Korea? I said, yes, I drive down through the under the ocean and they came out fine, all right? But anyway, so I came. It was a reason, and then I talked to my parents, I don't like to go to Japan, because first of all, that's not the theory and then research coming from. It's coming from the United States. If I want to get that source correctly, I want to go to the first place to get that right. So I came to the United States, was thinking that I am going to go back, getting my degrees, master's and my PhD, and I'm going to go back to my country and contribute to change things. Modify things. I'm not going to be changing whole structure of it, but at least I'm the change agent to change things around the country. But then American Dream came. So I don't know American Dream actually, but I didn't have one at the beginning, to tell you the truth. So I came and I studied for it. And then when the time came to graduate, I got an opportunity to work at a childcare center. So I was a teacher for preschool teacher and then toddler teacher. And then one of toddler's mom was a school teacher and she really, really liked me. So she said, why don't you apply for the substitute teaching position? So I went. And then from that on, I learned about this country's racism, discrimination, you name it. So those panels talked to really nice things, but I had a little horrible experience through the against biases. And then because I'm yellow, I'm not yellow, I'm tan, okay? But people call me yellow because I am Asian. And then they think, first thing they see me, do you see me as Chinese? They always call me, are you Chinese? No. Are you Japanese? No. Then they cannot tell me who I am, but I'm Korean. So I have to, I went to school and then my assistant teacher was very white supremacy. Is that right way saying that? So she treat me like third, although I had more education than she does. But anyway, I got to learn about calling me yellow And then I got discriminated in certain points of my life. So I learned to be stand up. I was very quiet Korean girl. Maybe you're not believing me, but I was rambunctious, but at the same time, very quiet. But I had to learn to stand up myself that no, this is not gonna work for me. So from that moment on, I learned to go against the biases. I learned to against the people who are not educated to let them know that they are, we are living in a society is really diverse. So I got into the graduate course, and then my assistant chair told me, she offered me a job as a graduate student who can teach courses. And then that opportunity, when it came, I grabbed it. And I thought, this is really good country giving me, as a foreigner, a job. You know, I cannot speak English very well. She said, it's okay, I can understand you, you can do it. No, my English sucks. How can I do that? I don't know how to memorize things. I don't know anything about it. But she said, you're gonna do it, Gina, you can do it. So under her wing, I got trained to be a professor from that on. This is my American dream came true, that I never thought that I'm gonna stay here forever. I'm living it in 20 years now, and then, I have a husband, and I have a daughter who is 10 years old, and then I have a dream that she's gonna be living in a country that can express her ideas, her thinking really freely, and then be able to accept it by others without her skin color or without her gender issues, without her cultural differences that that will affecting her. So. In sum, I think my American dream that I got an opportunity equally, but along the way, I had to against it, I had to overcome those obstacles that who am I now become, who am I? So if you are going through those immigration is not cheap. Okay, I had to pay $12,000 to get my permanent residency. So ladies and gentlemen, if you are thinking about going through it, put aside your money so that you can get paid for it. And then you have to study for testing because it's really not easy, okay, if you don't know the political system here. So, but go for it, it's worth it. It's worth living here, express myself, that whom I am, as a professor, and then I am associate professor. So my dream came true all the way. Thank you.
Thank you. I think I might not have fully immigrated yet, even though I've been here for most of my life. I came here in 93, and even though I have three kids here and a family, and a dog, and a cat. And I say this in part because my parents are still in Bulgaria, and that keeps me connected. Also, came for accidental reasons, and it was really strictly accidental. In a way, I was part of this mass exodus after the fall of communism. I came here in 93, communism fell in 1989, the Wall of Berlin fell in 1989. So anyway, that's not the accidental part, but I was debating whether to admit this frivolous reason, but I was chasing a girlfriend. She was going to come to go to a college in Georgia, and until the last moment, she deposited, she didn't end up coming, but going. I said, well, what the hell, I've already signed up for it. I was accepted to various universities in Europe and in Bulgaria, but I ended up coming here to and I was in that college because she went there too. She was going to go there. So it was a Catholic school in North Carolina. And I was quite taken aback by the place, but it really worked out. On the other hand, it really wasn't accidental because my dad, who's a philosopher, or philosophy professor, sociologist, all these things, he went to Toronto in '74 and loved it, to a conference. Then he came back, and my mother became pregnant on the fumes of his trip, of his excitement about Toronto. This is the girlfriend theme continues. He's a socialist, communist believer. But he thought you should go to North America, and the United States is part of North America, even though he liked Canada. So that was one reason. Another reason, it wasn't accidental. When communism fell in 1989, I was extremely excited to start thinking about the world and about politics. So I remember running to the British Council, which is a British cultural organization. Maybe they had a library, and I could read English. And I went to read Locke, John Locke's second treatise, and just because I felt the whole case was busted open. Now we can think about. I mean, I know I wasn't going to decide the fate of the world, but I could think about regimes. I could think about politics freely. And I thought maybe my dad will push me to go to America. And I want to know somehow the foundation of this country, insofar as it's founded theoretically in Locke. So I came in 93, and it was very easy to leave at that point. And I spent the first night in New York, and I was really shocked. I was taken aback. So, but everywhere I went, I was delighted and horrified and fascinated by the United States. So first in New York, I spent the night in Queens. It was pretty crazy as I was 18. And then North Carolina, the highways, Cracker Barrel and Waffle House, all these places. Then I go to Georgetown, Washington D.C., and they tell me 4/5 of the city is off limits. Don't go there. And then Chicago too. Actually, I moved from Washington D.C. driving, and the rugged, deindustrialized. Scenery, landscape, sort of shocked me and horrified me. But despite all this, I've had a very sheltered existence, in a way that comes back to the fact that I haven't immigrated. I've always been with these ideas. I've always been at a university since 93. Never held a job outside of a university. And the American universities are some of the best universities in the world. So that came very easy for me. And I just love being part of that. I mean, my parents are academics too, and they're pleased that I found my place here. My mother had a temporary idea that I'll become a banker or something like that. But that was that seemed impossible and against nature. We dropped that quickly, and that's the meaning of it. But I would say, as a philosophy professor, the country is interesting to me. It's a philosophical country in a couple of ways. It's the center, and it's, in a way, it's the center of the world. The fate of this country determines what's going to happen to the world. So it's a fascinating country. And it's evolving, it's dynamic, it's ambivalent. In a way, it's very diverse. You have the South, and you have Silicon Valley, you have Chicago, you have New York, all these places. And capable of absorbing errors, capable of self-criticism to a large extent. So it's an amazing place to be in and to watch. And I think, now that I have a whole family, the dice have been cast, and I'm on my way to fully immigrating. Thank you.
So I guess I'm going to do something a little bit different, and I'm going to tell you about my family. I'll tell you about the history of my family, and I know everyone is so excited to hear about my family, right? All right. Well, I grew up in a very small village in a very small town in Bosnia. And everything was going really, really well until the 1990s. My father was a heavy machinery operator. He worked in Croatia, which is a different country, for those of you that don't know. It was usually about a four-hour bus ride from Zagreb, where he worked, to Teslic, where we lived. And he used to come home every weekend. My mom was a housewife. All of you moms out there know that that means she did 20 different things every single day, right? She took care of us, she helped my grandparents, she took care of the land around the house, and did everything else that needed to be done. My dad used to come home every weekend up until 1990s. In 1990s, the war in Croatia started. So it wasn't really safe to travel as much anymore. So then we would talk to my dad once a week when he called, and he would tell us about the bombings and the air raids and having to hide in the bathtub because there were airplanes flying over Zagreb, picking their newest target. In 1991, at the end of the year, it was New Year's Eve. We usually would celebrate as a family, get together with our aunts, uncles, and have fun. But that year, my uncle, who had come home from Croatia, was guarding the village. Him and the rest of the men were walking around with makeshift weapons, looking for danger. And at one point, in the middle of the night, he came, told us to turn off the lights and hide. And we did. So we hid for a couple of hours, and then he came back and said it was a false alarm and everything was fine. 3 months later, my brother went to school, came home, and told my mom that soldiers had moved into the school building next to them. 2 weeks later, my brother came home and told my mom that a soldier had slapped him while he was out playing with one of his friends. My mom went to school, and if any of you knew my mom, you'd know she's a soldier. She could touch her kids, but no one else was ever allowed to. So my mom went to school, went to the principal, and screamed. The principal basically told her that she has two choices. She either keeps sending my brother to school, or she goes to jail. My mom wasn't about to send him back to school with an entire army located in the building right next to them. So she spoke to my dad, she spoke to her brother, and they decided it might be best if we left and went to Croatia. So on April 20th of 1992, we packed all of our belongings in two suitcases, and we went to Croatia on what was supposed to be a two-week vacation. We ended up staying in Croatia for 8 years. My mom went from being a housewife to being a cleaning lady, initially at a bank, then at a pharmacy. The lady who ran the pharmacy was a doctor, really nice lady. She has since passed away, but at one point she needed someone to help her fill out the paperwork for the payment bureau. Since healthcare in Croatia is socialized, just like it is in most of Europe, all of the paperwork would go to this payment bureau at the end of the business day. So she asked my mom if I might be interested in doing something like that. So I did. I did that for a couple of years. And during that time, the pharmacist would let me come into the back and meddle with the ointments and help them prepare the pharmaceuticals that they were working on at the time. It really got me interested in pharmacy. In 1995, the peace accords were signed in Dayton, and that basically resulted in Bosnia becoming a divided country. So the country was divided into the Federation and the Srpska Republic, which is the way the country exists today. Our home fell into the Srpska Republic portion of the country, and my parents weren't comfortable with going back. However, since we were in Croatia, my brother, my mother, and I, we were in Croatia on a refugee visa, they were starting to ship all the refugees back. So the choice was, you either go back to Bosnia, to wherever you want, or you apply for a visa to come to the United States or go to Australia. We chose to come to the United States because my aunt was already here. She had come here from Germany. So we decided to come to the United States. Our aunt sent us a letter stating that she would accept us as her relatives to come in. She worked with an organization called the International Organization for Migration, IOM, to help us gain a visa in order to enter the United States. The same organization paid our plane tickets to get here, and we finally made it here on June 5th, 2000. Again, with suitcases and 2,000 Deutschmarks at the time. Really not that much money to start a new life with. My parents didn't speak English. My father still barely speaks English. If he tries to speak to you, you're probably not going to understand a word he says. So I translated. Everywhere we went, I was the designated translator. If we needed to call the phone company, I was the one on the phone call. I remember so many times telling people, you know, they would ask me for my mom's date of birth, my mom's address, and I would never tell them they're not talking to my mom. I would just keep talking and giving them the information that they asked for. Because if I told them that I wasn't my mom, then I'd have to get my mom on the phone and she doesn't speak English and they'd have to wait for a translator, and it would just be this whole big thing. So I spent a lot of time translating for my parents. My brother and I got our first jobs before anyone else in the family, because my brother spoke some English that he learned through TV, because in school he was taught Russian. I had learned English in school in Croatia, so I spoke English pretty well, and I went to apply for a job at Dominic's, which is where all of the Bosnians worked, right? Because that strip of Kenmore from Foster to Loyola was basically little Bosnia, so everyone worked at Dominic's. My aunt included, of course. So she was a deli clerk, and she took me to see the store manager. His name was John, really nice guy. He looks at my application, and he says, well, you used to work at a pharmacy. We have a pharmacy tech position open. Why didn't you apply for that one? And I literally looked at him and said, well, I really don't know what to do in a pharmacy here. I don't know how to work in a pharmacy, but if you'll give me a chance, I'll certainly learn. My other question to him was, if this doesn't work out, can I still be a cashier or a bagger? So, I interviewed with him. I interviewed with this lady named Tammy. And I was supposed to hear something back, but a week had passed by and I hadn't heard back. 2 weeks had passed by and I hadn't heard back. So I went into the Dominic's. And I walk up to the pharmacy, and this lady is working there, and she looks extremely busy, doesn't have time to give me the time of day. So I go up, and I go, well, hi, is Tammy here? And she goes, no, Tammy doesn't work here anymore. I'm like, uh-oh. I'm like, well, you know, I'm supposed to be the new pharmacy tech. Do you know if I still have a job? She looks up. She goes, oh, you're the new tech? I'm like, yeah. Do you know when I start? She looks at me and she goes, how about right now? So I walked back behind the counter. She gave me a pharmacy coat. And I remember during those first few days, I kept asking people for recipes, because the word for prescription and a recipe is the same word in Bosnian. So I was asking everyone for a recipe, and people would look at me like I'm crazy. My pharmacist would look at me like I'm crazy, because she kind of thought the same thing at the time. I stayed with Dominic's for several years, ended up going to pharmacy school while I was at Dominic's, worked for Dominic's up until the moment they fell apart, then went to work for Mariano's for a couple of years, and finally ended up at Roosevelt University. And as I said, I'm a pharmacist, so I teach our students how to be good pharmacists. I teach them how to do blood pressure measurements. I teach them how to do blood glucose measurements, how to talk to their patients, how to communicate with other healthcare providers, things like that. And I think, to me, the American dream is exactly what I have right now. It's a stable job, a job where I know I will get paid, and I won't worry if my next paycheck is coming or not, even though I've earned it. It's having a family. I have two little ones. I have a son who's 5 and a half, almost 6. And I have a daughter who's 4 and a half, almost 5. having them be able to go to school without people looking at them like they have horns on top of their head. Having a husband who's able to start his own business as an immigrant and run it successfully for years on end without speaking perfect English. My husband to this day does not speak perfect English. He speaks it well enough to understand people. He can read it well enough to understand the emails that come through, but he cannot respond. I'm usually the one responding to his emails. So that's what the American dream is to me.
Okay, well, first I want to have some general considerations. For me, the United States is a fascinating society, right? If you think about it, it's the only developed country in which slavery was done extensively. Any other country, for instance, Great Britain or France or Spain, participate in slavery, but in the colonies. And that makes a big difference because the American Revolution was about also democracy, equality, respect of the law. So having those two facts put it together, you can see that, you know, it's a very complicated situation to handle. And you can understand why, for instance, the Civil War. Because, I mean, trying to abolish slavery was not something that easy when there was a whole economic interest behind it. But the states are, in spite of that, those contradictions have been a tremendous change, right? And as Michelle says, nowadays from the 50s in which African American were unable to sit in front of the bus, to have an African American couple living in the White House built by a slave, is an undeniable change in the society. And this isn't my other reflection. Probably I'm getting old. When I was younger, I believe in the revolution. Now I believe more in evolution, right? I think that, you know, because those change, even with the whole forces against them, are here to stay. Instead, for instance, if you see the Russian Revolution, there is nothing left. There are no traces of it. I think that, well, going to my personal story, I came to the US for my PhD, and I got my PhD in Minnesota with Jim Phapes, that was a student of Anthony Sigmund at the University of Chicago. So I am part of what is called the Chicago School of Harmonic Analysis. So when I came to Chicago, was I always say, like a Muslim going to Mecca. It was the proper place to go for my expertise. Of course, as a Latin American, a leftist Latin American coming to the state, I have my reservations and quite a few of my friends look at me, you know, if I was crazy. I learned a lot of mathematics at that time, but I learned a lot of this society and how it changed. And I changed completely my view of the world after that. I stayed one more year after I finished my PhD. I went to Temple University for a postdoc. And then I went back to Venezuela until the Chavez regime convinced me that there was no future there, right? And that's the the third part of my talk is about the American dream. I mean, I came back in 2004 as a visiting professor in the University of Kansas. And nowadays there is a lot of talk about the attack to liberal democracies, right? Where populist demagogues profit from the imperfection and problems of the society. Brexit, Le Pen, Trump are examples of that. But my experience in Venezuela is that Chavez was an important reference of that attack. It's a good example of a sociopath narcissist that believes that he's the only one that can fix the social problems. The tragedy, the Venezuelan tragedy, that after the highest income in oil is facing a human tragedy, a human crisis, or an humanitarian crisis, where there is no food, no medicine, it's a reminder that democracy is a very delicate flower that if you don't take care of it, it can be destroyed very easily. So from that experience, I am convinced that history not always go forward, it can go backwards. And the involution of the Venezuelan society is a painful example of that. So I'm middle class. My father was an engineer. My mother a lawyer. Being here in the States, I believe the American dream still exists. But it's getting harder and harder to achieve the American dream. The income inequality is staggering, right? When I teach calculus 2, the project that I assign to my student is the Gini index that is a measurement through integral calculus how the wealth is distributed in a society, in a group, in a nation, and in a region. And when you see that the United States, with all the wealth nowadays, has the same Gini index that, say, Mexico, or even Venezuela, you see that there is something wrong, right? But of course, we are in a very difficult times. I hope that I don't have to emigrate again, because I tell you, to me, Trump is like Chavez, but speaking English. So, well, I live my American dream. I think that what she said is, I mean, have a decent life, being able to achieve your dreams and your potentialities. That's the American dream. That is not only the American dream, it's the dream of any society, a reasonable society.
Yeah, so my story, my name is still Cornelius Watson, by the way. So the president mentioned about the name change. During my citizen exam, the guy did ask me, did you want to change your name? And I said, okay, no, I think I'll keep my name, Watson. So that was very interesting. I did not expect that. But so I grew up in the rural area, the rural parts of Jamaica, up in the hills, from very humble beginnings, in a farm family my father and mom. They had 11 kids, so we grew up on a farm. Resources were stretched thin, but they certainly believed in education. So they made sure that we went to school every day, whatever it is, maybe to take advantage of the lunch school lunch program, whatever it is there to keep us fed. So I luckily for us back then, the government, there was a scholarship program. You had to take an exam and pass a scholarship, go to high school. So I was lucky to pass the scholarship. The rate in my class was 2%. So that was, whoa, I was so lucky to have gotten one of those. So after high school, universities such as Cornell, Tuskegee, all those, they used to promote their programs very heavily down there. So I applied to both Cornell and Tuskegee. Tuskegee was very efficient with their processing. And of course, they also trained a lot of the vets in the Caribbean. So I decided to go to Tuskegee. So here I am, and I decided to go early. I decided to go to summer school that first year, just to get used to coming to Alabama. I noticed that the pharmacist in my area, she said, I told her I was coming to Tuskegee, but then she said something puzzling. Oh, are you getting ready to become a second class citizen? I didn't understand what that meant at that time, but I guess over time, after moving to America, I really understood what she meant by that, but you know, that was very interesting. But anyway, I came and I got a promise of a loan from the Student Loan Bureau. And the Student Loan Bureau was run by the Bank of Jamaica. So what they do, you know, foreign exchange, you have to have foreign exchange to pay tuition. So they would give me a loan to pay my tuition. Given that I have my first year tuition, which I did, I have my first year tuition for college. I came in bright-eyed, ready to go. But in the middle of the first year, I got a Dear John letter from them, saying that, sorry, the student loan system has gone belly up, and so they will not be able to honor their commitment. So there it is. Now I am where I am, hundreds of miles away from home, and in a different country, and having to face that. So anyway, I finished my first year, and then luckily, and like this morning, I just let me mention about the philosophy of the American dream. This is not only my dream, it's a collective effort, and also includes all the individuals along the way that play a pivotal role in the realization of one's dream. Because there it is, I now had to grapple with the issue that I don't have any money. My parents, they don't have a penny. Most of us then, after high school, that's it. That's as far as they can take us. So we had to find our way through. So luckily, then, the U.S. government had a policy where if through any unforeseen circumstance, as a non-immigrant, you find yourself in financial straits, they will award you a work permit. So luckily for me, I got a work permit to work full-time. So during the summer, here I am now, trying to find my tuition for the next semester. Luckily, and people talk about the American dream getting harder. Yes, nowadays, I don't think I could have made it today under these circumstances with tuition being, you know, anywhere from 25,000, 28,000, 30,000, 40,000. At least that time in Tuskegee, my tuition was 3,600 per year. So I was lucky then. At least I was able to, you know, see what I could do in the summer plus a part-time job on campus. So I was able to salvage my undergraduate education by working during the school year, and then during the summertime, trying to get a full-time job to save money to go back to college. So all those professors along the way, one of my major professors, Dr. Carter, I can't forget him. When I went in for advising, when he looks at my GPA, he writes a letter to financial aid. I know the student is not qualified for federal aid, but please find some private foundation to grant him some money to help with his tuition. Till today, I still remember that, because when I see students struggling, wherever they're from, whether from the inner city, wherever, I have to try my best to see what I can do, at least contact financial aid. Can't you do something? Walter O'Neill was here, one of the financial aid directors, who was gone. I used to interact a lot with him because I try to get student, get him to find ways to help students to finance their education. It is so important because part of the American dream, that is what it's all about, helping others to realize their dream as well. And so there were many players helping me along the way to realize my dream. From there, from undergraduate, luckily, I was able to apply to a master's program, and in that master's program, they offer partial tuition, stuff like that, so I was able to finance my degree that way. And then I moved on to a PhD program in Connecticut, and then to a postdoctoral fellowship there also in the same state. From there, then, I moved on to Roosevelt. So I've been very lucky. Earlier this, at one of the welcoming ceremony, welcoming reception, I said to some of the students, I'm very fortunate. They asked me, what do I like about Roosevelt? And one of the things I mentioned is that I'm very fortunate since I came to the United States. I've always been able to go to a quality institution, one that cares about people. From Tuskegee to Wesleyan to Yale to now to Roosevelt University. I love it because with the social justice mission here, it ties right into the American dream. I've had many opportunities to leave Roosevelt since I got here, but no, I decided to stay here because this dream, this mission fits well with my view of what we're supposed to do, and that is to help others realize their potentials. So my dream continues, it evolves. Again, I have fulfilled a major part of my dream. I came in as a non-immigrant to go to college, because we believe strongly in education. Got my degrees, and it continues today. So one, I'm involved in at least trying to do my best in educating the next generation of scientists. As I jump at every opportunity now to serve on panels. For example, I'm on the National Institutes of Health panel that awards grant money to help underrepresented students in the sciences. I'm busy, but I know it's something important to do. I've also served on a panel, it's a steering committee that comprises of scientists. For example, in Chicago, there are members from Northwestern University of Chicago. They call us once in a while to go to Capitol Hill to talk to people on this House and Senate side about the importance of science education and about funding science. You know, it takes time to do that, but I think my fellow citizens are responsible to try to advocate for those who are underprivileged. Yeah, so the American dream is becoming more difficult. Yes, we have a lot of problems, as mentioned earlier here. I mean, we are not there yet. But hey, this is America. We work at it. And that's one thing that drew me to America. America has the will to work through its problems. We can do it. So with all the racism, with all the discrimination, mark you, some of those I've also experienced in this country, you know. But hey, that's part of the landscape, and we have to roll with the punches. But I'm very excited to be here, to be sharing in this dream. I love it. The dream still lives on. Thank you.
Thank you all. Can we give another hand for all our panelists and sharing their stories? We have about 13 minutes left for questions if people have some. Before I open it up, just wanted to frame a couple of things and themes that I had heard from this panel. I think their experience in immigrating here, I think, resonates with what many generations of immigrants have come to this country for, right? In search of a better life for themselves, their family, opportunities, in some cases love, right? That brought them here, but not new, right? I think a lot of the political discourse, looks at immigrants here coming for maybe more nefarious reasons than earlier generations, but our panel here you know, demonstrates that they have come for the same reasons that many generations, you know, have come. There's also the reasons why people come, the push and the pull factors of, you know, their home countries and some of the civil unrest or political oppression that I think sometimes Americans don't appreciate, right? The sacrifices, the struggles of immigrants in coming here, and I've heard that not just in this panel, but in many immigrants that I've worked with. And I was struck by, Wilfredo, the comment you talked about, you know, democracy. And I've heard here in Chicago, our Cook County Board President, Toni Preckwinkle, who was a history teacher before she became a politician, but she described democracy as the most fragile form of government because it depends on an active citizenry, right? And, you know, I think each of you have shown a story and a reflection about, you know, what it means to achieve the American dream and to be, you know, kind of present in the moment and aware of the things going on around you. So with that, I'd like to open it up to the audience if you have questions. Yes, sir.
Hey, Zarco, Tom Kernan, a faculty member in the Music Conservatory. Since you specifically mentioned going and reading the philosophical underpinnings, going and reading Locke before coming to the U.S., I'm wondering what that experience was like once you got here, if that in some way set up an ideal that you've been trying to achieve, or if that left you somewhat cynical that you read all of this and then the nation didn't quite measure up. How did you reconcile getting Locke and then getting America?
That's a very good question, but you're tempting me to reconstruct it creatively. And you know, because it was a bit of a haze. I mean, that was in 89, and even 90 is a bit of a haze. That was at the same time that there were a million people demonstrating for the new government. I don't think I understood Locke then or now, but I saw. I mean, for example, the idea of this is a big idea that I did read about acquiring property. Or, is it limited? Is it unlimited? It's a very complicated chapter, and I didn't think of Locke as the ideal. I thought of it as a very deep analysis and of the roots of the American society, of the American regime, and identifying, for example, this idea of acquisition and to what extent it should be limited, to what extent it should be unlimited. So I think, again, I might be idealizing or romanticizing what my insight back then. So when I thought of it, as I said, I thought of it as an opening to think freely about what societies can be. And I go and read Locke, and I went and, I don't know what I was, I mean, I was, for some reason I was reading English stuff, but sort of Solzhenitsyn and so on. So yeah, so I wasn't disappointed when I came here. Of course, I was shocked by everything I saw. But I wasn't disappointed because reading Locke did not create an idyllic picture for me.
I'm gonna be honest, I don't really have a question. I know more about immigration than I'd ever want to know from working at INS, but I just wanted to thank you all for sharing your stories, because when you listen to new immigrants come to America, the one thing that you learn is that nobody wants a cookie cutter life. And in America, we still have an opportunity to where you can live your own life, your own direction. And I thank you all for sharing your stories to remind me of that.
Hello, my name's Andrew Jones. My dad's from South America. So I just have a question, kind of confusing. Why do you guys think it's harder to achieve the American dream now than it was in the past? I mean, we live in a country where we had slaves like literally not too long ago. So like the opportunity to achieve the American dream was only available to a certain amount of people. Whereas now it's the availability to it is much wider. But I don't understand why it would be a lot harder now. The only reason would be like economically, but I don't understand why it would be harder now than it was back then.
Go ahead. I think that, you know, all the issues that we're having, for example, 9/11, so the door to the immigration got closed a little bit more and more. It's not opportunity that you can, far back then when I talked to my friends who got in here in 90s, 60s, 70s, they were open arms and everybody can come in. This is melting pot that we're gonna, everybody come in, welcome. Now that it's getting difficult to get through the immigration and it has a lot of obstacles to go through. So according to my lawyer, he said doctors, lawyers, and then professors or teachers get the first rank. So you get processed quickly compared to someone who come in as a blue collar. So the door to the opening is getting smaller. That's what I think it's you're mentioning on parts of it. Yeah. And then
Part, but yes, you mentioned economic. And my take on it is more economic than anything else, because when you look at wages versus tuition, if you look at when I went to school in the 80s versus now, I mean, when you look, you know, the minimum wage hasn't gone up that much. Tuition is what, maybe quadrupled, quintupled, something like that, and wages have not. So yeah, that's from the economic standpoint, it's so much difficult now. Like I said, Roosevelt's tuition is, although they offer a lot of financial aid and all those things, but when you look at a student like me, who was not qualified for any federal aid. As a matter of fact, in many programs, even at the PhD level, I was still a non-immigrant. They had so many scholarships still available at that time, so many. But it's like being at a party and all the platter, everything, caviar, the everything, and you can't touch a piece of that. Because they say, sorry, you'll be qualified, but you're not a permanent resident or whatever. So for those who are not qualified for those loans and all those things, it's a major obstacle now.
And yet, more people are going to college now than ever before. And so I think each era has its own problems, and we have to face courageously the problems we have now. But I don't buy the idea that our era is any harder than any other era. In Europe, you still see the walls that had to be built around cities to protect them from the neighbors, sort of thing. We still have that problem in assuring our security. Now you see it on the lines at the airport. And we don't build walls, or maybe not yet, to assure our safety. But so it has changed, but the issue of being safe is an issue that is of all times, I think.
I just wanted to add, I think when you study, for instance, from 1945 to 2010, the concentration of wealth, and how, for instance, the tax system changed dramatically, right? And then, you know, rich people pay less than the secretary, you know, you see that, you know, that implies less investment in infrastructure, less possibilities of educational financing and things like that. So, I mean, just look, and you can check that. I mean, you can just Google US Gini Index, and I have been going up and up and up. That is worse, right? So it's around 0.45, and you know, you say that number shouldn't be. The best country is in, say, I think it's Sweden or Denmark, is 0.20 something. So United States, and it has been a phenomenon exactly after the 50s.
According to the stop clock here, we got 2 minutes. We got time maybe for one more question.
This won't take very long. This is a little bit personal. I'm so curious to know, of the panel, I'm curious to know how many of you had brothers and sisters, had siblings that that followed you here? And I'm also curious to know, if you go overseas to go back to visit nuclear family, perhaps, if you do that, I would just be curious to know how often you go back to visit.
My brother is here in the state, my two sisters are in Venezuela, my mother, that is 94, is there. So I have to go at least once a year, Christmas time. And every time it's harder and more depressing.
So my whole family came with me. My parents, my brother, we're all here. My husband has a mother and a brother back home. We have a second home there. We used to go every year until we had kids. Now we go typically every other year because it's tough getting the kids there and back without tiring them out too much for just a couple of weeks or.
Yeah.
I have a large extended family. They're all here. I have one cousin in Cuba. 5 years ago, I went back for the first time after 50 years. And that cousin picked me up at the airport, and we were like, we had been with each other all this time, sort of thing, instant rapport kind of thing.
For me, yes. I have a brother in Pennsylvania, but migrated on his own. Sister in New York, migrated on her, and she has a family there with kids and everything. I do go back. I hold, by the way, Jamaica allowed dual citizenship. You don't have to renounce one to get the other. So they gladly, because with us too, just like Mexico and places like that, remittances are very important. So we always send money back to relatives there because they need it. So they always encourage us to keep our citizenship, you know, so at least, right? It benefits them. As a matter of fact, I heard on the radio there, their radio, it's about 18% of their GDP, what we send back to the island. So they have a vested interest in us, you know, keeping our citizenship. So, you know, hold a Jamaican passport, you can do that too. But if you do travel with American passport, you're treated just like a visitor. But if you want to go and stay maybe a month or so, it's probably best to go in as a citizen of that country.
I think according to this clock here, we're out of time. I just want to check with the program folks. So I want to thank again the panel. Please help me thank them.